Hi. In this video, I'm going to refactor the movement code using state machines and add a few additional movement types to my third-person controller using them. A state machine, also called a finite state machine or a finite state automaton, is a conceptual machine that can be in one of a finite number of states at a given time and can transition into one another based on certain inputs. In traditional programming languages, we usually represent states using class instances or functions, but in Godot, we can just use nodes to make use of stuff like exports, signals, node hierarchies, and even inheritance. So let's see how it goes. To start off, I create a top-table folder called scripts, and in it, I create a new script called stateMachine. In it, I add a class name statement, a signal for the transitioned event, a notepad export for the initial state, and a field for the current state. In the init method, I add the node to the state machine group so I don't have to do it myself, and then proceed to implement regular underscore methods for input, unhandled input, process, and physics process. In these methods, I call the current state similarly named method without the underscore at the beginning, and this way I'll eliminate the risk of processing states other than the current one. Finally, I add a method called transitionTo to have the state machine transition to the given state, and call it with the initial state field in the ready method. In the transitionTo method, I check if the given node path is correct, the node at that path is a state, and it's different than the current state. If so, I call the exit method of the current state, update the current state with the new one, call its enter method, and then emit the transition signal. For the base state script, I add the node to the state group in the init method, and I also add onReady references to the state machine that owns the state and the state's parent node. To get the state machine, I add a method called getStateMachine, and in it, I traverse the node hierarchy upwards to find the first node that's in the state machine group. If there's no such node, I just return null. Next, I add non-underscored methods called enter, exit, input, unhandled input, process, and physics process methods, and in them, I just call the parent node's same method if the parent itself is in the state group. With the base state class in place, it's time to design the state machine that will handle player movement. Currently, the player can either be standing still, running around, jumping, or falling down. Based on these actions, I came up with three states: stopped, running, and jumping. In the stopped and running states, I will determine the horizontal velocity of the player, and in the jumping state, I'll determine the vertical velocity of the player, covering both falling, jumping, and re-jumping actions. So first, I go into the player script and make sure it has a class name statement. Next, I create a new folder called states under the player folder, and in it, I create a new script called player state. I extend the player state script from the base state script, add a class name statement, and get an onReady reference to the player node. Next, I go into the player scene, add a basic node with the name movement, and assign the state machine script to it. In it, I add three basic nodes with the names stopped, running, and jumping, and for each of these, I create new scripts with the same name and extend them from the player state class. I also set the movement node's initial state to the stop state, but as I was implementing this code, Godot sometimes didn't show me the exports, so I had to restart it. Anyways, I then proceed to move the existing movement code from the player script to appropriate states, including all of the exports. I also remove underscores from shared player fields like skin, camera, and controls to indicate that they're public fields, but this is just my preference and you can just ignore it. In the end, the player script contains a single export for the max slope angle, two fields for the horizontal and vertical velocities, an underscore physics process method to combine the velocities and call move and slide, and a method called hasMovement to check if the player is trying to move or has any horizontal velocity. In its process method, the stopped state checks if the player is trying to jump, and if so, it transitions into the jumping state. Otherwise, if the player has any kind of movement, it transitions to the running states. The running state contains the exports, fields, physics process calculations that relate to the horizontal movement, and a process method to transition to the jumping state if the player is trying to jump, or to the stopped state if the player has no movement. Similarly, the jumping state contains all code pieces that relate to vertical movement, and it immediately transitions into the stop state when the player is on the floor. We could also check if the player has movement and transition into the running state if that's the case, but the stop state already does that for us, so we're good. With all of these in place, we can see that we can still run around, jump once or twice, or fall off edges, but since the jumping state doesn't change the horizontal velocity, we cannot move while in the air. At first, this might seem bad, but it actually made our movement code much more flexible, so we'll fix it later. Now that we have a state machine in our hands, it's time to add other movement types. The first of these will be dashing, which will allow the player to slingshot themselves in their current movement direction, and the second will be sprinting, which will allow the player to run faster. I go into the input settings and bind the Q button to the dash action and the shift key to the sprint action. In the control script, I add two new boolean fields called isDashing and isSprinting, and I add aptly named methods to return these values. In both cases, I want the player to be able to dash or sprint continuously as they hold down the button, so I use input.isActionPressed instead of isActionJustPressed to get their values. At this point, the stop state is like the root state for grounded movement, and I'm not really happy with that. The base state implementation already supports node hierarchies, so instead of this, I'll go ahead and make a new state called onGround and move the stopped and running states under it. To do that, I go back to the player scene, create a new node for the onGround state, and assign it a new script extending from the player state. Next, I move the process methods from the stopped and running states over to the onGround states, and I combine them there, making sure to rename the transitions to account for the new state hierarchy. I also go back to the jumping state and transition to the on-ground state instead of stopped when the player is on the floor. To demonstrate how flexible states are, I'm actually going to implement the sprinting state as a simple flag in the running state, so I go ahead and add a sprint speed export to the running state. In the physics process method, I check the controls nodes is sprinting planned to determine the actual run speed, and while it does the job, it feels a little bit too strict. If we were to implement sprinting as a new state, we could actually reuse the running state code with different move speed and turn speed values, resulting in a much more flexible and intuitive movement code. So this is something to keep in mind. Anyways, for the dashing state, I go ahead and place a new node under the onGround node and assign it a new script extending from the player state. I want the dash ability to have a cooldown, so I go into the onGround state, add an export field for the dash cooldown amount, and a field to count towards this cooldown. I add a method called canDash to return if the cooldown has been reached, and in the process method I count towards this cooldown. Next, in the if statement chain, as a new entry, I check if the player is trying to dash and that they can dash, I transition to the onGround slash dashing state. In the dashing state, I add an export called dashPower to determine how much to propel forward, and the boolean field called willDash to determine if the dash is going to occur. In the enter method, I set the willDash to true, and in the physics process method, I make sure to call the super implementation of physics process, and transition back to the onGround state if willDash is false. If not, I set it back to false and immediately move the player in the direction they're facing with the dash power amount, and transition into the onGround state. Note that I don't want this to be interrupted, so I don't change the player's script's horizontal velocity, and instead directly move the player body in that frame. Now when I run the game, I can hit Q to dash and hold it down to dash continuously as its cooldown is reached. The player can also dash off ledges and defy gravity momentarily, but not while they are jumping. To fix this, I'll refactor the in-air movement pretty much in the same way as I did for the grounded movement, and add a dashing state under it. For that, I create a new state called inAir, move the jumping state under it, add a new node called dashing right below, and assign the dashing state script to it. Dashing midair is much more powerful than dashing on the ground, so to compensate, I drop down the dash power on the dashing node to 40. I also make sure to transition to the parent node's path rather than the stopped state when the dash ends, because I'll be reusing this state script for both grounded and midair dashes. Next, I create a new state called falling and give it an empty script extending from the player state. Similar to the onGround state, the inAir state will act as the root state for all midair movement, handling state transitions and gravity calculations, as well as counting cooldowns. To implement that, I copy all code from the jumping state over to the inAir state and add fields for the dash cooldown. In the process method, I count towards the jump and dash cooldowns, and add an if statement chain to transition into jumping, falling, or dashing states. In the physics process method, I just leave the on floor check for transitioning to the on ground state and all the gravity calculations from before. The new jumping state is pretty similar to the dashing state, and it contains an export feed for the jump force and the wheel jump flag. In the enter method, it sets this flag to true, and in physics process, it calls the super implementation, returns immediately if the flag is false and transitions to the falling state, and if it's true, it sets it back to false, sets the player's vertical velocity to the jump force, and transitions to the falling state. With the scripts updated, I rename all transitions to the jumping state as in-air/jumping and run the game. Now, not only I can jump around like I used to, but I can also dash while in midair. To finish off midair movement, I'll have to add some air control, which is essential for most games, especially for platforming. For that, I simply go into the in-air state, copy horizontal movement code from the running state over, including the exports and the calculations in the physics process method. And I also make sure to decrease the default value so the player can't move as fast while in the midair and run the game. Now the player can use horizontal movement keys to adjust their footing while in the air. Another key feature of most games is crouching, so let's implement that. I begin by binding the control button to the crouch action, and similar to the dash and sprint actions, I use isActionPress to store this value in the controls script and return it from a method called isCrouching. Now, I don't want the player to be able to dash or jump while they're crouching, so I'll create a new root state. For that, I go into the player scene, add a new node under the movement node, call it crouching, and assign the new script extending from player state. Under the new crouching node, I add two nodes, stopped and moving, and assign them the stopped and running state scripts respectively. Next, I adjust the movement parameters on the moving node to slow down the movement a little bit, and then move on to implementing the crouching root state. For that, the only thing I need is a process method to handle state transitions. If the player is not trying to crouch, I transition to the on-ground state. If they have any horizontal movement, I transition to the crouching/moving state, and if not, I transition to the crouching/stopped state. Next, I go into the on-ground root state script, and in the if chain, I add a new handle to transition into the crouching state if the player is trying to crouch, and that's it. So let's run the game and see what happens. And voila! It's difficult to see, but when I hit the control key, the player slows down, and during this time, I'm unable to dash or jump. To finish off, I just need to update the mobile controls with the new actions. For that, I go into the controls node, temporarily make the mobile controls node visible, and drag the icons for the dash, crouch, and sprint actions over to the assets folder. I want to add them in a cross pattern with identical spaces around each button. So to do that, I add a VBox container inside the button's controls node, set its anchor mode to center, give it a constant separation of 32 pixels, and in it I add three more nodes, a center container for the first row, an HBox container for the second row, and another center container for the last row. I'll move the jump button to the first row so it's at the top. I set the HBox container separation to 128 pixels, and inside it add two of my custom virtual buttons. I rename the first button to sprint button, set its action to sprint, and assign it the sprint icon. Similarly, I rename the second button to dash button, set its action to dash, and assign it the dash icon. For the last row, I add another virtual button, rename it to crouch button, set its action to crouch, and assign it the crouch icon. Lastly, I set the modulate color of each new button to the 999999 value I used for the jump button, and I hide the mobile controls in again, and plug in my Android device to test it all out. Once I run the game, I realize that the player keeps dashing even though I lift off my finger, because I actually forgot to release the synthetic action that I triggered in the virtual button script. To fix that, I go into the virtual button script, store the finger index on the initial touch, and when the finger with the same index is lifted off the screen, I call input.actionRelease to tell Godot that the action was released. Now when I run the game again, everything works perfectly. It would even be better if I highlighted the virtual buttons as they were placed, like coloring them in blue, but maybe later. And so that's how I implement state machines in Godot and how I use them to create movement systems. I'm really happy with the result, and I'm confident that it will allow me to easily implement any feature that I might think of. Previously, if I wanted to implement another movement type like swimming, I wouldn't even know where to start. But now I just know I can create a new root state and transition into it when the player moves in and out of what is off order. Or if I wanted a gliding mechanic like that in Genshin Impact, I can just implement a new state with less gravity pull and place it under the in-air root state. I hope I was able to explain stuff clearly, and I hope you found this video useful. As always, the code to the example project is in the description box below. Thanks for watching.